Hi, welcome to Latest TV News. I'm Mark Walker.
So I'm joined here today by Toni Amanda Coe-Brooker. You're the production manager at the Green Door store in Brighton, but you're also the campaign manager for the Save Our Venues campaign. Welcome, Toni. Just tell us a bit about the campaign first, maybe, and then we can go and talk about a bit about the Green Door store and why it's important to save our music venues.
Okay, cool. Thank you for having me. So on Monday, we announced 107 venues that were at risk, set them all up with crowdfunders and put them under one sort of umbrella for the crisis fund. And over the last 3 days, we've managed to raise nearly 200K for music venues in crisis. So it's been going really, really well.
Yeah. They're in particular danger at the moment, aren't they? Because of the coronavirus outbreak has meant that music venues, that they were some of the first venues to shut down, weren't they, in the end? So.
Yes, I mean venues have been in crisis for a long time anyway. The Music Venues Trust is this amazing charity that are set up to support venues that are facing, you know, kind of like noise threats or issues with neighbours or, you know, anything really, rents being up to like an extortionate amount. So they're there to kind of like help protect and sustain the whole of the sector, really. And they've been an incredible support to everyone. But these venues, we were already 2 weeks away from closing, you know, two bad weeks away from closing. So it's been a very vulnerable industry to be a part of for a really long time. And 2 years ago, the Music Venues Trust had just been able to start sort of like stabilizing the whole thing. We actually saw venues starting to open rather than close, which was amazing. But then obviously we got hit with this crisis and it's like undone so much good work. So even from the aspect that, you know, Arts Council got involved and they were able to pull together a fund for grassroots venues, which, you know, have historically been under-supported and underfunded. And yeah, they put several millions together to kind of help venues, you know, buy new equipment, work with programming, basically to help infrastructure. And that whole fund got slashed when COVID-19 hit us. And it became a crisis fund for the kind of historical arts venues that were receiving annual funding. So yes, it's been a massive shock to the system. And being someone that works for a venue, I've just seen the whole of my calendar cancel for the next 6 months, which is really scary because we just have no timeline for when we can open again.
Yeah, and that uncertainty just adds to the kind of the difficulties music venues are in. And we've experienced that here at the Latest Music Bar as well. So maybe tell us a bit about the Green Door store then and the great musical acts that you've had on there.
Okay, well, I mean, I've been working for Green Door Store as their production and programming manager for the last nearly 5 years. And, you know, we kind of specialise in supporting, I guess, the younger bands in Brighton. We work very closely with BIM. We also work with Water Bear. We put a lot on a lot of free entry shows because we don't really want music to be a financial barrier to anyone. So we like to think that we're kind of working with lots of different groups within the community in Brighton and Hove. You know, we have a radio station called Platform B, which is a not-for-profit and it's youth-led and operates out of Green Door Store. So at the moment, they're not even able to be at GDS. I guess we do put on a lot of international and national bands, but I'd say that they're mostly through promoters. However, once a year, we do an annual festival called 234 Fest, which is where we kind of bring in some bigger bands like we've had bands like Pup, who are obviously not from the UK. We've had Petrol Girls, we've had Culture Abuse, we've had Milk Teeth, lots of really, really cool bands. And then we try and mix them up with lots of local bands to see. It's just nice to kind of like platform local with bigger national, international bands.
Yeah, we're going to listen to one band now, aren't we? So we're going to listen to Libra Libra. They've played at Green Door Store. So let's take a moment to listen to Libra Libra.
Put the pool lady in the pistol, swing it around. what's more. Giving me them storm cold shivers, I'm getting aroused, your core. You make it rain, so I can give it up. You make it rain, so I can give it up. You love a boy, and you love time. Coming from that storm.
So tell us a bit more about Libra Libra and why they're showcase the kind of the great stuff that you do at the Green Door Store.
I put them name forward because I just think they're a fantastic band. They're so like high energy and exciting to watch. They literally just give it their all every time they get on the stage. You know, I've seen them play to hundreds of people. I've seen them play to only a few people, and they always give it the same every single time. And I just think that their sound is really unique and interesting.
And these acts, they need to establish themselves through music venues. There's only about 8 left, I think, in the city of Brighton, isn't there? So we've seen quite a few close already, and we really want to keep the ones that we have here left. We want to keep those, don't we, for the future?
Yeah. Well, at the moment we've got 7 from Brighton that are on the crisis list.
Yeah.
So, including yourselves. So we've got Latest Music Bar, The Pipeline, Comedia, Old Market, Green Door Store, The Hope and Ruin, and the Prince Albert. These are all really, really important venues to our community. I mean, the Prince Albert is obviously like an iconic music venue in Brighton, and to have them on the crisis list is going to be a real shock for our local area. And not just not from a social aspect, but also from an economical aspect. You know, if we lose even one of these venues, that's going to be really bad for the economy in Brighton and Hove.
Yeah. What has the coronavirus outbreak done then? Apart from obviously all your acts have have disappeared for the foreseeable future. You've received help from the Music Venues Trust, I think. You've received some support from the government, or how's that been for the Green Door Store? Because I know there has been some support available, hasn't there, from the government?
Well, only the business loan kind of aspect, really. I mean, there hasn't been any funding at all. I think that it's possible we'll see more help from the government in the coming weeks. But at the moment, we're still struggling because we're still having to pay our rent. We're still having to pay our bills. We had to front all of our furloughed staff. I think this is what's really interesting about working in the campaign. A lot of these venues have staff that are on 0-hour contracts and don't necessarily have to furlough their staff. And I've seen a lot of businesses around the UK that have just let people go. You know, you see like Wetherspoons has let 40,000 people go. And the social responsibility from all of these venues is just, it's been incredible. They've all made sure that their staff are furloughed. They've all made sure that if there's possible work that they can, you know, keep paying for, that they will do, you know. It just shows an incredible kind of like strength, I think, from our whole industry.
Yeah. When do you think music venues might be able to get back up and running again? Because you mentioned a big pub brand there. They're saying that they might get back in June, for example. I mean, it's that uncertainty because we don't really know. But do you have any kind of timeline at all?
I think it's impossible to say. I mean, there has been speculation about June 30th. For softening the lockdown, but that's not softening it for music venues. I think that it's possible that a few more shops will open. I mean, there's going to have to be a whole timeline of how we can open safely for the public. And at the moment, Music Venues Trust are trying to put forward a really, really good plan for how we can do that safely, not put anyone at risk, and also not lose any more music venues. I don't think that we'll be looking to open for a few months.
Yeah. Going back to the Green Door Store then, I know we're going to come up to the end of the first half. We're going to listen to Feral Youth. So this is another band that's played at the Green Door Store. Tell us a bit more about that before we listen to them.
I just think they're great. You know, they are super moody, really cool, very, very nice people. And they've been very, very supportive of the Green Door Store. And I think their sound is just great, really great.
Okay, let's take a listen.
No without danger. I am a stranger, but I used to be the one chasing holes in pavements 6 feet down at once.
Brilliant, and we've really enjoyed your music. We've loved speaking to you, Toni. All the best of your campaign. We put the details up on the during the program as well. Thanks for talking to us. All the best of the future. We'll stay in touch. We're now going to listen to it.
Thanks for having me.
Cheers. Take care.
That's it for the first half. Join us for the second half. Welcome back to Latest TV News. I'm Mark Walker.
We're going to round things off in magnificent Brighton Pride style with the one and only Fatboy Slim in the Wild Fruit tent.
So I'm joined here today by Norman Cook, aka Fatboy Slim. Welcome to Latest TV, Norman. Hope you're well. You've got Lagoon Fest coming up again. It was a great success last year. This year's going to be even better, and you're now the patron. So how's it feel?
My there's a spring in my step daily, knowing that I'm a patron rather than just somebody who turns up. The whole community around the lagoon is very close to my heart. It's where I live. It's where we've got the big beach cafe. And I'm very happy in being part of that community and very happy to be a patron of it and an ambassador.
Yeah. Lagoon Fest has been a big success. It's really promoted that area of our city, hasn't it? Got a big beach cafe there, but that area in general, it's a great place to be, and it's put it on the map a bit more, hasn't it?
Yeah, and I mean the nicest thing about it, when they originally had the name Lagoon Fest, it sounded like a rock festival. And the thing is, it is more of a village fete, really. But it's like dog shows and tombolas, and so it's a family thing. But it's just cementing our relationship with the community and all the different people who use that park, just all getting together and enjoying each other's company. And since it's 6 years now we've had the cafe, we really feel like they're quite proud to be part of that community. And it's a lovely little vibe. You know, every park in different parts of the city have got their own vibe, and it's quite nice, our vibe.
Yeah, exactly. How did our idea first come about? Because it kind of seems obvious. It's a great place to have a festival, a Lagoon Fest, isn't it? Given that where it's right by the seafront. But
It bore originally out of our frustration about trying to get anything out of the council in terms of the playground facilities were falling to bits, and we just felt a little bit unloved. And Robert Nemeth, who's one of our friends and a local user of the park, also a councillor, he just said, well, look, you haven't got any collective power because you've got no, you know, if you all banded together, then you could go to the council and say, we would like that repaired or we'd like that done. And so he sort of talked us through the process of becoming friends of Hove Lagoon. And that was great because we did feel like all of a sudden we could get things done. Because before you could just beat the council up and we were very low on their list of priorities. So we've now got sort of collective power. And when we started having meetings at the cafe about it and forming Friends of Hove Lagoon, somebody just suggested we should have our own little thing. Because I don't know, my kids have grown up going to, the one at Wish Park, the one at St Anne's Wells is really good, and every park seems to have their own little. And it's good. It's good to just to bring everyone together and have a celebration of your community. So we've just been feeling left out, and Rom Nemeth, and as soon as we started doing it, everyone realised that it's quite fun. It's quite fun having this kind of collective power and getting these disparate people together. You know, you've got like the water sports people and all the businesses around the thing. And, you know, collectively we can have fun, and it just seemed like a good way of having fun.
Yeah, this could be one of the first events following the lockdown. If we don't know where we're going to be with the coronavirus crisis, but it could be one of those events where people might want to let their hair down. So what better place to be than the Lagoon to do that?
Yeah. Obviously, in the current situation, you know, it could have been quite easy to say, look, let's not do it this year. But what we're going to try and do is just stay until the last minute. If we can't do it, we can't do it. Yeah. But if it was a big commercial concern, like all my shows and all the festivals and everything, they've all gone down because of the financial aspect of cancelling it now is a lot cheaper than cancelling it further down the line. But we're going to just hold our nerve. Because most of it is done with volunteers, we're going to hold our nerve to the last minute, because if the lockdown does allow us, it has gone by then, and we are allowed to do it, everybody is going to want to get together. What a fabulous, if that is the week when we're all allowed to see each other again, what a fabulous way to celebrate it. So, we're under no illusions that there's a very, very big likelihood that it won't happen. But we just kind of collectively decide to carry on regardless until the last minute. And also it gives us something to look forward to. You know, these times, troubled times for us all. And it's nice to have something to look forward to rather than just saying, let's just cancel the year. Let's cancel 2020.
Yeah, exactly. How's the lockdown been for you, Norman? Because a lot of us have spent time listening to your music. That's getting us through the lockdown. How about yourself?
I've had a bit. We've had some fun doing. Yeah, we did that little broadcast with my daughter DJing. That was fun. And I do a weekly mixtape on Fridays for kitchen weekend kitchen raving. But apart from that, very quiet. Obviously, I've lost all my work, basically, probably for until the autumn. At the moment, and possibly for longer. So, but I've got my daughter here, so I've been homeschooling her, and she having a 10. Well, I had for the first month there was 2 10-year-olds here, so that keeps you busy. And to be honest, just homeschooling and looking after the kids, and just planning and plotting things. Like I said, having something like this. To think about and talk about and because one day, the good thing is, it will be a slightly different world that we come out of this, that comes out of this. But we are all still here, and one day it will be over. And then, sadly, it won't be like VE Day where we can, it'll be in small increments. But hopefully Lagoon Fest will be part of that continuing reopening of our lives. And we all have to look forward to that.
Yeah. Just before we go, how do you see that world changing? Do you think we're going to be a bit more local? I mean, Lagoon Fest is all about being local, localism. Got local last year, loads of local stalls there. Do you think that's where we're heading?
Well, I think one thing that a common peril brings us all together in terms of community. But obviously this particular peril meant we couldn't physically be together. So, but a lot of great communities have grown up around, looking after neighbours and, pub quizzes on Zoom and things like that. So the community is still there. And I think we will definitely cement it more when we're allowed to see each other again. You've got to appreciate the things, there's certain restaurants that I just, I really miss, I'll appreciate them more. And also everything will be a lot more local at first, because that's all we'll be allowed to do. I think, international holidays and that, I don't think there's going to be a huge amount of foreign holidays going on this summer. So there's going to be more local fun to be had. So, but I think we will all come out of this a little bit more thoughtful about where we are in this world and our relationship with our neighbours and our friends. I'm hoping that the politicians will recognise that the value of the NHS after all this is over. Exactly. A little bit worried it's great what Captain Tom is doing, but they shouldn't forget that the NHS isn't a charity. It's something that should be nurtured. And I'm hoping the NHS will never get under. Be under so tragically underfunded after all this, And yeah, like I said, I think we've all just had a time to think more about us rather than me.
Yeah. Missing the football, the Seagulls?
I'm missing the football. Obviously, I'd be more than happy if they did scrap the season right now and we kept it and we didn't get relegated. I'm not missing the football as much as I thought I would. I really thought it, but I mean, we're coming to the end of the season anyway. But the worst thing about it is that kind of that cliffhanger that we left it on, which was two points clear of safe. Hold on one sec. It'll be 2 minutes, darling.
Yeah.
So it's lunchtime. Yeah. It was lunch break from homeschool. I'd be glad when the cliffhanger is over and I know whether we're going to get relegated or not.
Yeah. Lastly, you've got a message for the city.
My message to the city is, I miss you all. Stay home, stay safe, and stay sane.
good on it. Norman, great to talk to you again. And all the best for the future. Catch up soon. All the best for Lagoon Fest. Cheers, mate.
Thank you. Thanks. Cheers.
Thanks.
That's it for tonight. Join me for more of your local news stories tomorrow. Good night and keep safe. Stay at home.